Problem. All right, we got the recording going. Welcome and thanks everyone for attending. I appreciate it. My name is Mark Martin, and my role in the Bay Area is I'm what's called a regional director for advanced manufacturing. And what that means is I am here as a resource for K-12, for community colleges, and for industry to help them in any way that I can around manufacturing. And that means connecting those different groups together so that the industry is connected with the community colleges and K-12 as far as finding future employees, helping those people get trained at the different schools. And in just any way that I can, I'm a resource. So if you're a teacher, a parent, an administrator, and want to talk to someone about manufacturing, about who to connect about manufacturing, I encourage you to come to me and we'll put my contact information in the chat box at the end. And I, if I have time, I'll try to chat, type it in as I'm moving along here. So today I want to give you a kind of a quick overview of manufacturing in the Bay Area, types of manufacturing, talk a little bit about careers and pay, and just give you an opportunity to ask questions yourself. Okay. So one of the things I wanted to ask you is, first, if you want to put it in the chat box, is what is the largest manufacturing country in the world? Okay. So if you want to type it in the chat box, you can put it in there. Get a couple seconds. The second question I'm going to ask you, and you can put this in the chat box as well, is has manufacturing in the US declined, increased, or stayed the same over the last 30 years? So since the 1990s, which was not that long ago in my terms. And then three, when you think about manufacturing, what do you think about? Okay.
And let me just make sure, Alex, can you make sure the attendees can write in their chat?
And if not, then you can just think about this to yourself.
Or could put it in the Q&A also.
Yeah.
That's open now. Thank you.
Okay. You want to try it now while you're doing that? Because I think this is an important thing is that, you know, many people look and think about manufacturing in the US and talk about, you know, how we don't manufacture as much as we used to, how not as many people are as employed in manufacturing as there used to be. And one of the things that, you know, really my job is to get the word out about manufacturing and what it's about. And the fact is right now, you know, China is the largest manufacturer in the world. Now, that was not true until about 6 years ago when the U.S. was still the number one manufacturer. China has increased. The U.S. still has about 15 to 20% of the world's manufacturing, though. China is larger. But think about it. China is 1.5 billion people. They have large, huge infrastructure needs, which often is counted towards manufacturing, where they're and also supplying a large middle income base of people who didn't have things that we had before. So they're manufacturing a lot of cars for internal use, you know, TVs, a number of other things. China is a large powerhouse manufacturing, but the US, with, you know, quite a bit smaller population, is still very close and has more manufacturing output per person than China does, okay? And this is in GDP. As far as whether or not manufacturing has declined or stayed the same, let me show you a little chart. It's from 2015, I think, but the numbers are still increasing. So here, down here at the bottom, it, you know, we start at 1920, and manufacturing output increases, and it's a normalized scale, so it's kind of based on a scale of 100, has continued to increase, and there's a little blip right there. Those little blips where they drop down are recessions, and this big blip right here, for those of you who remember, it was the Great Recession of 2008. So it dropped, our output dropped quite a bit, but it's increased. So it continues to increase, and it will continue to increase. You know, U.S. manufacturing is actually very strong. One of the things that has occurred is that the overall employment has been, while it has increased over time, it has, you know, decreased at times and has more recently stayed relatively steady. I mean, it will drop, but it will pop back up again during kind of recessions. the reason we're still producing as much as we do with lower, you know, kind of less employment overall is because we are more productive and we're getting more output per person in manufacturing. And that's because of the advanced manufacturing aspect of it, the use of computers, automation, but not only that, but advanced training for our employees. So it's much become much more of a skilled job in manufacturing than maybe it used to be in the, 50 or 100 years ago. Okay, so let me show you a little bit about that. So, used to you would see these kind of manufacturing lines, and there are some still in the United States, but not so many, where you would just have hundreds, if not thousands of people on a line manufacturing something. And this, in this case, they're actually manufacturing kind of maybe looks like possibly a food product. But, in general, it kind of gives a sense of what it would look like. You know, manufacturing line, conveyor belts, assembling these products. And so it wouldn't take a large, a lot of skill to do this. But nowadays, what manufacturing is about is the skilled trades. You're training how to do these, different manufacturing skill sets, and it takes typically additional training after high school. If you have a really good high school that has a manufacturing program, you can pick up a lot of these skills in that program. But typically, that's not as available so much in high schools nowadays, and it occurs in the community colleges, which is, I'm based out of the community colleges. Okay, so a lot of different, computer skills needed, manual skills about how to do things. Some things have been around for hundreds of years. Machining, which is kind of shown in this picture right here, manual machining, has been something that's really been around for the past couple hundred years. The level of skill needed to do that, though, is incredibly high. And I see this, I actually work where I sit at Laney College in Oakland. They have a really strong machining program. The level of skill there is incredible. I'm a mechanical engineer myself, and I got my PhD in mechanical engineering. And the skills and knowledge that these people have on how to machine and make stuff is incredible. Okay, I certainly can't do what they do. And it's a core essential part of what manufacturing is about and an important skill set that we have. So I'll talk a little bit about that more in a minute. I want to show a video here. Some of you may know who this is. If you're younger, you might not. This is a comedian back in the 50s called Lucy. And this is a fairly famous video about manufacturing, what it used to be like.
You're fired.
Yes, ma'am.
Let her roll!
Well, this is easier. Yeah, we can handle this, okay?
Splendidly.
So thanks for indulging me on this. I've seen this a number of times and it still makes me laugh. So, but I do this as a lead in to this video that I'm going to show next. I mean, this is the way they would used to do things on a conveyor line, people doing things, people packaging things. And this is what we have nowadays, where we have automation. This is 150 ppm, which is pieces per minute. So, you know, as you can see, the, it's going to start it again. As you can see, what is, the important part is that, you know, used to they would use manual labor to work on those things, and 150 pieces per minute would require, you know, probably 2, 3, 4 people at least to do something like that. And so with automation, we have, you know, quite a bit, you know, more productivity and able to do things a lot faster. Now, what that means is less, you know, people needed on that manufacturing line doing that kind of rote job that's over and over and over again. And so we've decreased those numbers. And that's why generally manufacturing numbers, kind of employment, have, you know, either kind of plateaued, gone up and down, but, you know, over time are not growing like our actual output has grown. Because what we need instead is the people to build those robots, to maintain those robots, to program those robots in that automation. Okay, so there's a lot more of that coming along and less of the kind of rote types of jobs that honestly, you know, it's not a particularly job that most people would want to do. So really we've kind of outsourced those jobs that people don't want to do more to automation. And the fact is, you might think in the Bay Area, there's not a lot of manufacturing, but it is actually a fairly large percentage of our GDP. I think it's about the fourth largest category of jobs in the Bay Area, you know, behind education, behind kind of professional types jobs, ICT, you know, computers and stuff, behind government. But we do actually have quite a few jobs in the Bay Area, over 250,000 jobs. There's a variety of different companies, lots of food manufacturers in the Bay Area, which is something we, you know, typically keep close, you know, to a location is the food manufacturing, and we like to have that. There's still jobs in the Bay Area where they're actually melting metal and creating things. So there's a lot of casting and foundry jobs, a lot of medical jobs, stents. There's Intuitive Medical, which makes, you know, robots for doing surgery and stuff. Jelly Bellies. There's actually quite a few. There's five different refineries in the Bay Area, and just, you know, obviously Tesla. There's bikes. This one over here is water. You might not think about water as being manufactured, but it is in a way, because we have to get it to you into your home. We have to take the water and the waste that, you know, comes out of your homes back out, and that's done through the utility districts. East Bay Mud, if you're in Oakland, Union Sanitary, there's different districts throughout the Bay Area. They hire these kind of skilled workers, which to me I consider manufacturing, people that do machining, people that do maintenance. So there's all sorts of infrastructure jobs there as well, including things like BART, AC Transit. Again, you might not think of those as manufacturing, but really they're using the same skill sets. They're doing machining, maintenance, electronics, hydraulics, pneumatics, all these things which you teach in the manufacturing skill trades are useful for the infrastructure. So this is a lot of different jobs in the Bay Area in manufacturing, and a lot of different companies, okay? You saw some of those pictures earlier. You know, one of the things that pops up there, which you might not think about, is over here on the you know, left, which says Google. So if you think Google is, you know, more of a search engine, they are, but they do quite a few things in the hardware space. They're Waymo, which is their car division, which is making autonomous cars. So they build prototypes here. And whereas they might, you know, eventually outsource it to, you know, other companies to build the cars, they're actually involved in quite a few projects where they bring on skilled tradespeople at their facility to make prototypes, be it the Google glasses, be it the cars, and other types of products that they make. So Google actually, I consider a manufacturer, and they do hire people in the skilled trades, you know, as well as Apple, Paragon Bicycles, and a range of other companies. There's quite a few manufacturers out there in the Bay Area. And one thing is that it's very diverse. One of the things about the Bay Area is it has quite a diversity of manufacturers. Obviously with Tesla being probably the biggest, well, it is the biggest manufacturer in the Bay Area, and they're doing quite well. And you know, even though it's you know, high cost of living we have here in the Bay Area, you know, they're able to hire people and bring a lot of people on. And a lot of those people are skilled tradespeople. And so they need that. But we also have, you know, again, food, refineries, we have, you know, small, you know, bicycle companies, you know, companies of all different types. And that's beneficial so that when there is a kind of a downturn in one particular industry, it doesn't hit us quite as hard as it does other sections of the country. And let me be clear, these jobs are good jobs, well-paying jobs, jobs that you can continue to grow into and that you can have really as a career for the rest of your lives, okay? Machinists, these are kind of the range of pay that we see in machinists and welders, industrial maintenance, QC techs, engineering techs. Now, machinist is someone who cuts metal, and they take it and they use it for a range of different purposes. You know, your phone has some metal parts in it. They're probably machined. Anything made out of plastic is typically injection molded, and those are made using metal molds, which are machined and such. These lower end numbers here for the pay are probably lower. They're actually, I mean, they're probably the very lowest end of what you would see in the Bay Area, and they're actually more than likely higher. I've seen people starting off, for instance, in machining, I've seen people start off at $20, $22 an hour, which is about $40,000 to $45,000 a year. I've seen some people start off in machining with 2 years of high school, or not, 2 years of college experience, community college, starting off at $65,000 to $70,000 a year, okay? Excuse me. We had one young woman who had dropped out of high school. She had a young daughter, dropped out, came back at when she was 18, started a community college class in machining, very sharp, did well, completed in 2 years, and came out and started making close to $70,000 a year by the time she was 20, okay? That was at one of the local refineries. These types of jobs are available out there, and they're going to continue to be available because what we're seeing is a lot of retirements as people in the skilled trades are older and are, as they're starting to retire, there's a great need for them. And so, you know, there are quite a few well-paying jobs out there in these types of careers. And so let me show you this. This is one of the things that every year there's a company called Manpower that does a survey of companies and asks them, what are your 10 hardest jobs to fill? So skilled trades are these jobs, which I've been talking about, machining, welding, quality control technician, electronic technician. They typically refer to jobs that require more training than you'd get in high school, but not a 4-year degree. So either a 1 or 2 year certificate. So that, and this is what they saw in 2011. Let's start at 2011. So skilled trades and engineers, the top of the list. Okay. Here is 2014. So we jump ahead a few years. Skilled trade workers, number one, engineers, number two, technicians, number three. Let's jump to 2017. Skilled trades, number one, Got to move some things here on my Zoom to see engineers number 9, technicians number 10. 2018, skilled trades number 1, technicians 7, manufacturing 10. So I haven't grabbed the most recent ones yet, but I can guarantee you they're going to be the same. These are positions that are the hardest to fill in the United States and are hard to fill in the Bay Area. Okay. Part of that is because we don't have as many kind of trades programs in the high school. So kids are not as aware of it. They're not introduced to it when they're in high school to see what it's about. And so we don't have as many people entering that. And we also have this large number of people that are retiring. So there is a great need for this. And if you know, for those kids who like to work with their hands, who like to troubleshoot, who like to be challenged, these are some good careers to consider, all right? The skilled trades, the technicians, and anything kind of in manufacturing. So I'd really encourage folks that are really looking for something to do that they'd be passionate about to consider these and at least take a chance and look around. And the community colleges have a range of different training programs that can help you in this area. Everywhere from kind of a biomanufacturing technician, and these type of jobs are ones where you would work in, Genentech or other companies that are making kind of pharmaceuticals or, doing kind of any sort of biotech type products. CAD, which is computer-aided design. So which is using, the computer to do digital design of products and digital fabrication is important. Carpenters, electricians, electronic techs, HVAC, which is heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. So, most buildings, certainly most commercial buildings have some sort of HVAC system, and there are people that need to maintain that and work on that. So industrial maintenance. A lot of the food manufacturers and pretty much any manufacturing facility needs somebody to maintain their equipment. And that involves, working with computers, with programming, with gears and other mechanical systems and understanding how to troubleshoot. It's a challenging job. These are not mindless jobs. These are jobs where you go in and you are challenged every day. And so it really are a lot of great opportunities for kids and people who like to do this. Welders, quality control technicians are really important aspect of U.S. manufacturing, because really one of the things that, U.S. manufacturers are good at is producing high quality equipment, producing high quality products. And part of that lies with the quality control technician. So there's a great need for that.
Mark, we do have a question from our attendees. And it probably gets to, I'm sure you have a slide that talks about this. How many years are required for an engineering tech?
1 to 2 years. So the community college programs are set up for up to two-year degrees. And an engineering tech typically would take the full 2 years, although there are some engineering tech programs, that can be simply 1 year. You get a certificate that can get you a job, but to kind of move on to more advanced topics, you might want to take the second year, and you could do that, in the evenings while you're working. So that's what a number of students will do.
So would you say that some of the manufacturing pathways at the community colleges are what we call stackable kind of certificates or certificate program?
Yeah, they're stackable. Yeah, they're stackable in that you can get kind of a lower unit certificate of maybe even 18 or maybe even 12 units to some, and that's 4 to 5 classes. So you might be able to do it in a semester, but typically it might, because of prerequisites, and it might take 2 semesters. But yes, you could do that. Go get a job, with those skill sets. And then finish up the rest of the second certificate or the stacked certificate on top of that by going to school in the evenings.
Are there any two-year transfers?
There are two-year transfers, but the skilled trades is what would be called a terminal certificate, in that the things you're learning there, there are some that will transfer, but typically it's a little more geared towards getting you out and working in an industry. So like, for instance, I'm an engineer, mechanical engineer, and have worked in manufacturing for a while. The things that I learned my first 2 years of engineering were pretty theoretical. You know, you take chemistry, you take physics, you take, you know, lots of math. And so, you know, honestly, after my first 2 years, I could do a lot of math and I could do a lot of theory, but I couldn't do a lot of practical stuff. I couldn't have walked into a manufacturing facility and really made anything. And so that's the trade-off between, you know, that what they're doing in the community colleges is giving you that hands-on experience where you're certainly doing book learning in the sense that, you know, you still have to kind of, you know, read and go through books and stuff, but most of it is hands-on. And so that's the stuff that you learn in the community college programs that you wouldn't be learning in the first 2 years of like an engineering program. And that's, you know, that suits some people better than others. And so it's those, you know, if you're a kid, you know, you're a student who likes to work with your hands, you know, and is not as much into the kind of the book learning, the, you know, sitting in, you know, lectures and stuff, all, you know, for all your classes, you know, the skilled trades, community college programs could be something to look at and consider. And the beauty part of it is you can do it while you're in high school. And so I'll show you some programs here in a minute, but you know, there's lots of great programs. If you're in high school, it's really easy to, you know, say it's really easy to register. It's easy to register, pretty much so, but high school students can sign up for community college classes for free, okay? So there are classes at night that, you know, in the normal world, when we weren't all quarantined and doing stuff from home, but, you know, kids are in class during the day, but we would have high school students take a community college class in the evenings and do that there. And those would be free for them. You know, and there's various opportunities for you to check out these classes. It's obviously not the best time right now because a lot of colleges aren't doing the hands-on classes in person where you can actually run a machine. But, you know, once things open up next spring and in the fall, those are available. Now, there are still some available online, so you can check those out as well. Some like blueprint reading classes, kind of some of the basics. Okay? And after graduation in the community colleges, tuition costs are low, you know, $46 a unit, which, you know, you can go through a machining program like the young woman I said that completed a 2-year program and then started making $70,000 a year. You know, her total program cost was probably $2,000 to $3,000, including books. Okay. So compare that to a, you know, going to, you know, UC Berkeley or CSU, which is a different career path, but you know, that's $20,000 to $25,000 a year. And financial aid is available too. So even if that might be a burden, there's opportunities for that. So one of the, this is, you know, the website that I would recommend you go to, and I will type it in here and let me make sure I get it to everybody. So it's Bay Area Manufacturing Careers.com. Okay. And my email's on there as well, but I'll put it in here also. Okay. So what this is let me click through over here. Okay, can you see the website now? Okay. So this is just a resource that I actually use it all the time. It's something I put together. But like, let's say you wanted to know, you know, you're in a certain location and you know a college near you. Let's say you're in Oakland, you know that Laney College is near you. Here's all the 28 colleges in the Bay Area, by the way, which I work with, everywhere from Santa Rosa down to Monterey Peninsula, out to kind of Pittsburgh and Livermore. And so you want to, you know, Laney College is close by. Hey, what do they offer? So you can go to this website. This is for manufacturing only. They obviously offer a lot of other things, but these are if you're interested in kind of the manufacturing skilled trade side, you can see all that they offer. And if you're interested in something in particular, let's say industrial maintenance, you can click on that. And what it will do is it'll kick you to their website so you can see, oh, got to update that one. You can see what, oh, they must have just changed that. All right. But anyway, it will take you to their websites and you can get on there and look around. But you can get a chance to see, you know, what different programs are out there. Now, maybe you know which program you're interested in. Let's say, go back up here to the top, go to education. Let's say you know you're interested in computer-aided design. And then you can look here and see which colleges offer computer-aided design. And then you can click through on those and see what they have to offer. Go to their website, you know, kind of search through, see what classes they offer, when their schedule is, information about that, right? So that's kind of a good resource. There is information about jobs here. So I've kind of just set up different aggregator lists that you can click through. So, you know, if you just want to think about electronic technician, see what's out there. This takes you over to Craigslist. If you want electronic technician, this is a Simply Hired one. It just kind of goes through and looks for electronic technicians in the Bay Area, et cetera. So it makes it a little easier. And here's a few of the companies we work with as well. Now, you can also, there's newsletters that I offer, which would be useful for you to get on if you're interested. So there's a job postings newsletter. There's one for manufacturers. There's one for K-12 educators. I have a group of women in manufacturing skilled trades, which we're really trying to get an emphasis on. And let me say something about that. Traditionally, you know, unfortunately, there are, you know, jobs that are kind of gender, not defined, that are, you know, more gender unequal than other jobs. You know, nurses are mainly women. Manufacturing is more men. There is a growth in the number of women moving into manufacturing, and there is a high interest from companies to bring more women into manufacturing. There's no reason women, you know, shouldn't be in manufacturing. You know, certainly during World War II, the Rosie the Riveter, you know, hundreds of thousands of women moved into manufacturing as a large percentage of the workforce. And there's just kind of traditionally been that mindset that, you know, there's certain occupations that are supposed to be for men or women, which is just wrong. And it kind of hurts the industry, because whereas there is a shortage of these workers out there now, we need everybody to kind of consider. And it's a great industry to be in, and manufacturers really are interested in hiring more women. So if, you know, this is something that you would be interested in, I would encourage you to look at it. So you can go here and sign up for these different newsletters. You can get a job postings, or when I get job from industry, I forward it out to this list. K-12 educators are just things of interest around manufacturing that would, you know, the educators should know about, whether it be grants, whether it be opportunities for, you know, online learning and things like that. These are a good set of resources to go to. And then finally over here and more, I got just a range of different products. Summer programs, once those are back up again, listing summer programs that are happening in the Bay Area. There's a calendar. I talk about apprenticeships. There's some discussion forums about online learning. And then over here, there's kind of resources, where just a range of different resources that you can get more information about manufacturing, okay? I'm gonna encourage you, let me see if there's any questions yet. Where did my Q&A box go? The chat box. If anybody has any questions, put them in there. And while we're waiting, I'm going to show a quick video about, this is aerospace, but it's a lot of manufacturing in it. Thank you. the California has quite a bit of aerospace manufacturing in it. And we have some in the Bay Area as well. We have Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman is here. We actually, there's a small rocket manufacturer in Alameda that is developing small, much smaller rockets than kind of like what SpaceX does in Alameda. And so I've been over there. They have a testing facility that's been there, that was there for the last, you know, few decades that they're using to test rockets. So it's pretty interesting. So there's a lot of opportunities there as well. Okay. So, you know, with that, that's the main part of my presentation. I think the thing I want to emphasize is that there is manufacturing in the Bay Area. The jobs that are there are skilled jobs, and they're in need of skilled people who have kind of, you know, want to be challenged and want to be in it. And so my key thing is with kids is helping kids figure out if they want to do this. Kids just do not have the opportunities in high schools to kind of maybe fully experience what it's like to work with your hands, to do hands-on activities, to kind of create and design and use that particular part of their brain. And so any opportunities we can give them, small ones like just these presentations or a little information about it, but really to step into it, they need to actually experience it. And any opportunities we get them to experience that and let them know that these are good career pathways, I think is important to do.
Mark, I had a question. So when we talk about career technical education or CTE or career mm-hmm. education, as it's called in community colleges, yeah. there are not a whole lot of manufacturing pathways at the high schools. I know there's probably about 3 or 4 districts in Santa Clara County that have a pretty robust manufacturing, but they have other pathways that may crosswalk into manufacturing, such as construction, mm-hmm. Even hospitality and food services. So could you talk a little bit about like maybe what are some of the pathways that could lead to a manufacturing interest?
Well, I mean, you know, honestly, the community colleges are set up so that you could have no background in manufacturing or any previous classes in high school, and you could just start from, you know, ground zero. So there's no requirement there. If you do have a manufacturing program in high school, you know, you would typically maybe be able to get credit for that or just be able to really help you advance through the classes, you know, faster. So that being said, you know, it's really a matter of, you know, certainly construction would be a good one because it's just, hey, I like to work with my hands. What else is out there that I can work with my hands? CAD, anything dealing with design. So maybe you like, you know, maybe you have had a graphics design class or some sort of digital design class in high school where you're using Maya or Rhino or something that's, you know, maybe more on the gaming side or just the graphic side of using the computer to design stuff. But what if you want to design stuff, you know, that's actually ends up being a physical product? So that would be CAD design, computer aided design. And there's courses in that. In the community colleges. So that would be a good entree into it, you know, to say, hey, I like working on the computer, but I want to create something at the end that is actually a physical product. Let me take that knowledge I learned in high school classes and move into computer-aided design. So that's a good one. And certainly, there's other things as well. You know, it could be hospitality is just, you know, there are a variety of different jobs in manufacturing. That's also, I mean, maybe you like the idea of being involved with something that's producing products, but you don't particularly, you know, want to be a skilled tradesperson. Well, you know, they have customer service specialists, they have salespeople, they have, certainly they have engineers and they have accountants. They have a whole range of different things. So maybe that's the pathway you take. It's not necessarily considered a manufacturing job, but you want to go into the manufacturing industry because of, again, of being part of, you know, producing something and making something that people are using.
We had another question. What are there summer camps or programs or internships out there to expose high school kids to these possible manufacturing careers? Because there is a big push to have work-based learning opportunities at high schools Mm-hmm. But, and there are some programs like cybersecurity. I think they have cyber camps, cyber boot camps they have that comes out of one of the community colleges. So do you know of any summer camps or internships out there for high school?
I do. So, you know, that's, of course, we have to, the elephant in the room is, you know, pre-COVID and COVID. So a couple of years ago in 2019, I started putting this together, the Bay Area summer programs. And it was just really a list of not just manufacturing, although that was what I was most interested in, but just links to the different community colleges summer programs page if they had one. And so then in 2020, I would have updated it, but honestly, nobody was having any programs. So here's a, you know, here's a good list to go to. And again, as we see what's going to happen in this coming summer in 2021, I will update this and hope that we, you know, we are having programs. But, you know, you can click through and you would see, I don't know if this is, yeah, it's going to be there. You know, this would show, this is DVC's summer academies. So you can go to that. You know, like Oakland Unified, they have a big push to get students into internships and or into kind of community college summer programs. And I don't know if other districts probably do this to some extent. This I list right here is just for the community college program. So, you know, Laney, and I'm involved with Laney because that's where I'm hosted out of. But, you know, they were canceled, but we had, you know, a skilled trades program. We had a computer science program. We had an electric bikes program. These are the sorts of things that I, you know, try to post on this website.
We had another question about makerspaces. Mm-hmm. The makerspace is becoming kind of a big thing, and especially in middle schools. Is there a relevance to makerspace for this sector?
It's makerspaces are, yeah, you know, they're kind of like a library resource for your shop programs, right? And, you know, you used to have, you know, middle school wood, you know, maybe you might even have a middle school metal class, you know, in high schools, you would have these, you know, shop classes. And what the makerspaces are is bringing in that hands-on aspect of it, but also including the digital fabrication aspect of it. So you might, you know, design something on the computer and then print, you know, use a 3D printer to print it out. So Makerspace would have that equipment available. They might have also a laser cutter available. Some do, some don't. It just depends on how, you know, they'll have kind of a range of different equipment. So Laney has a laser cutter, has 3D printers, has a wood router. So you can take large sheets of wood and cut it into different shapes. They'll have the computer and the software available. They might have a vinyl cutter. And then they'll also have drills, saws, hammers, a chop saw or miter saw, band saw. So kind of that traditional older type of manufacturing equipment, which is still useful, but get a kids a chance to experience making something. And what we hope is that, you know, that kind of gets them more interested in it and saying, hey, I like this. What kind of career can I step into? What kind of things can I do that I can do more of this, you know, after I get out of high school? And so I think they are important just because we do have such a lack of shop programs in schools nowadays. And you can use it in art. I mean, if you have an art class at your middle school, well, what if you want to make a sculpture? You know, what if you want to make a physical aspect and not just paint? You can do a lot of things with those. You can incorporate those, that fabrication, that makerspace into producing, you know, physical art. What if you have an architecture program in, you know, probably more in high school? How can you make your models? Well, a makerspace can help you make those little components where you make those little models that, architects often show. Same with engineering, or if you're on a, you know, engineering team, or if you're doing a robotics team, you have to make a physical product. And so how do you do that? And makerspaces can help with that as well.
Thank you. And attendees, if you have any, we have about 10 more minutes left. So if there are any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box. I know there was a question about internships, and just as a side note, for Santa Clara County Office of Education, we are partnering with earn and learn. And we do have a work-based learning manager who's actually one of the attendees today, where we're going to be working with our school districts and partnering with local industry, San Jose Manufacturing being one of them, to see if we can get some work-based learning experiences for students. It may not be an internship, particularly in manufacturing. There is some liability that needs to be kind of ironed out for students under 18, but certainly guest speakers, tours, job shadowing, and that kind of thing. So keep an eye out, keep looking at our website, and we'll have more opportunities out there for our districts in Santa Clara County. Okay, Alex, looks like you got something here.
Yeah, sorry, I just put up the poll while any last questions are being asked or answered. If y'all could please participate, and then I'll also have a survey that you don't have to worry about until the call ends, but please, if there's any more questions, the conversation can continue.
So we did have, I think some of us that are in education mode know the lingo. Could you kind of explain quickly what a makers space is, Mark?
Yeah, makerspace, Fab Lab, Digital Fab Lab. Fab Lab stands for Fabrication Laboratory. It's a space where you have equipment that students can go to use it, you know, either as part of a class or on their own time to make physical objects. As I said, I like to think of it as a library. You know, some cities, in Oakland we have it, Berkeley has it, they have a tool library where you can go and instead of checking out a book, you can check out a saw or a spade or just, you know, things that you might need around the house to help you, you know, make stuff or destroy stuff or whatever that you don't have in your, you know, your own home. And so a makerspace is the same. It's a library to help kids educate themselves, to help kids improve their skill sets around something, except instead of reading, you know, what you might do at a library, you're going to use it to help figure out how to create objects. And again, it will have, you know, typically it would have computers in there because a lot of it is digital fabrication where you're designing something on the computer and then using that output from that computer to either send it to a 3D printer or just, you know, it just maybe just creating the plans about what you want to build. And then you go off and you grab a saw and a, you know, router and make it yourself. And so, you know, if you're making something in a wood shop, you might draw out the plans first before you actually build it by your hand. So it's a library for shop people, for people who want to make stuff. And that's why they call it a makerspace.
We had a question from one of our attendees who is interested in the summer camps. They're wondering if it's free for high school students or if there's any perhaps
scholarships or tuition. There certainly are. A lot of them are free. And then it's just going to depend on the college. And then a lot of them will have, if they're not free, if they do charge, a lot of times they will have scholarships to help any students who might not be able to afford it. And so there, it just does range from college to college.
And then also, I just wanted to let students know that if you are interested in taking a college course and believe you need to be 16 years or older, you can do concurrent courses at the community colleges. Your counselor should have those forms for you, and they will let you know whether or not that you could take those courses or not. So. And I know that, Mark, you had dropped a couple of things for people to look at if they're interested in manufacturing careers. I also wanted to let the attendees know that if Mark sends us the PDFs of the slides, we can make those available also.
Joel, thank you for correcting my spelling now that I look back at it.
Happy to help.
Manufacturingcareers.com.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you created this yourself, Mark?
Yeah. It's I created it for others, but I use it probably myself more than anyone just because it captures all my knowledge that I forget sometimes right here. So it really is a good centralized resource for educators to come to. You know, and just to close, look, you know, the you know, we have, as educators, you know, we see kids that have just a variety of different interests and skill sets. And the fact is that, you know, right now, they're about 25% of the jobs require a bachelor's degree. And every kid who wants to go to a four-year school should go to a four-year school. Every kid that is what is going to, you know, help them succeed, we should make sure that those people have the opportunity. But we should not discount the fact that people are going to do better, both kind of in their quality of life and what motivates them and interests them in a range of different ways. And two-year degrees, manufacturing, skilled trades is one way that are going to, you know, really speak to us, you know, a good number of people. And maybe that's only 10%, but that's 10% who need to know about it, because that will be things that will just motivate them. We have students that are coming back to take skilled trades courses that have bachelor's degrees. You know, one of the instructors at one of the colleges has a four-year degree from Berkeley in, I think it's German literature. And he, you know, that was a great experience for him. I know he enjoyed it. But the fact is, he is an excellent machinist and is now the lead instructor at Laney. And he loves it. And he made the wedding ring for his wife. He made it himself. I mean, he gets in there, he just enjoys it. And he didn't know he enjoyed it until he just randomly got into took one of these classes. And now he's, you know, the instructor. And so it's just helping kids find that path, and whether or not it's manufacturing or culinary or, you know, computers or whatever, that's my goal. As not to say that everybody should go into manufacturing, but everybody should find their passion.
Okay. Agreed. There may be a need a little clarification about, do you have to be licensed for these manufacturing careers? And then also, there was a question about workshops in Spanish, because we do have a lot of Spanish speaking. But yeah. So if you can kind of touch base on both of those real quick.
Licensing, no. I mean, there are a few trades, really, like you have to be a licensed electrician, okay? You do not have to be a licensed machinist. Some companies might want you to have a certain skill set, you know, a certain level of skills, but most of the jobs in manufacturing don't require licenses. There are some like welding that require you, they'll hire you, and then they might require you to get kind of a certificate they did basically a skills test, which is something you can, you know, maybe train, you know, take a few extra hours of classes to get good on about how to weld something this particular way. But in the most part, no, it doesn't really require licensing of any sort. Okay. On the Spanish, I don't know if they're talking about kind of introduction to the manufacturing, you know, like what I'm giving in Spanish. And unfortunately, I don't know of any off the top of my head that have kind of Spanish introduction to manufacturing.
And we can look to see if we have any Spanish literature that we can also make sure is available for students and parents. We, as a county office, along with the K-12 pathway coordinators, are going to start doing some information sessions about these different sectors with help with our regional directors. And so we can certainly look into getting some simultaneous translations as we're doing future webinars for parents.
Yes, definitely.
Well, thank you, Mark, for your great presentation.
Loved it. I appreciate it. Good luck to anybody. And again, feel free to reach out to me if I can help you in any way. That, you know, website, BayAreaManufacturingCareers.com, and my
it's 3:00.
My email is on that website as well. Okay.
Thank you all for attending our